I was born 80 years ago in a country called the United States of America. And I now live in a homeland. This is an expression we haven't heard since Hitler.
We have seen their kind before.
Nazi forces openly seek to establish systems of government based on the regimentation of all human beings by a handful of individual rulers who seek power by force.
They are the heirs of all the murderous ideologies of the 20th century.
Yes, these men and their hypnotized followers call the changing forces.
Behind them is a cult of evil, which seeks to harm the innocent and thrives on human suffering.
It was posted 1 week ago. Already, it's an online must-see. Canton police officer Daniel Harless berating a driver who appears to be trying to show Harless his concealed carry license so that Harless would know he was armed.
I'm so close to caving in your head.
But now comes a second video.
I'll kill every one of you mother.
This one from a year ago.
Now I'm telling you what, I will shoot you in the face and I'll go to sleep tonight.
Theirs is the worst kind of cruelty. The cruelty that is fed, not weakened, by tears. Theirs is the worst kind of violence.
Thomas was tased at least six times, hogtied and beaten by several police officers, ultimately putting him in a coma.
I'm charging Officer Manuel Ramos with second-degree murder.
By sacrificing human life to serve their radical visions.
We have before us the opportunity to forge for ourselves and for future generations a new world order.
They follow in the path of fascism, Nazism, and totalitarianism.
Union Banking Corporation was another American bank out of Chicago that was very instrumental in laundering Nazi money, providing funds to the Nazis, and guess who the director of Union Banking Corporation was that was in charge of that? Prescott Bush, the grandfather of George W. Bush and the father of George Herbert Walker Bush.
And this is an interesting picture. This is three generations of Bushes, Senator Bush, President Bush, and President Bush.
During the Bush administration, they couldn't call it National Socialism. That had bad connotations. So they called it neoconservatism, the neocons. When you hear about the neocons, just understand we're talking about National Socialist.
They stand against us because we stand in their way.
Was this punishment for a baseball fan's smart aleck remark to police officers on the eve of the G20 summit? Sean Salvati, the man shown naked in police custody, says yes, it was. He obtained the police station video as part of a lawsuit. Salvati's statement of claim says Toronto police officers strip-searched him, hit him, and paraded him naked in front of a female sergeant.
They hate our freedoms.
It's happened to a college student in Tarpon Springs.
What the Tarpon Springs police did was wrong.
To a homeowner in New York.
You're not listening to our orders right now.
Even a news photographer.
Put it down.
All arrested for simply videotaping police on duty. Only problem? It's not illegal. A U.S. Court of Appeals in Boston has now confirmed that with a ruling saying filming cops in a public place is your choice, protected by the First Amendment.
Our freedom of speech.
There are very few things that encapsulate how far down the road we've already gone than free speech zones. What an Orwellian phrase, a free speech zone.
Freedom and fear are at war.
Excuse me, sir, you're getting very close to me. I don't like that.
Yeah, good. Give me your license, registration, insurance card.
Am I under arrest?
Did I say that?
No. Am I legally required to do that?
Yeah, if I ask you for it.
I don't know if that's true, sir. Can you show me that law? You're getting very aggressive with me, sir. I don't like that at all.
The advance of human freedom, the great achievement of our time, and the great hope of every time, now depends on us. This generation will lift a dark threat of violence from our people and our future.
No, I'm telling you what. I will shoot you in the face and I'll go to sleep tonight.
Every nation in every region now has a decision to make. Either you are with us or you are with the terrorists.
You can roughly locate any community in the world somewhere along a scale running all the way from democracy to despotism. One community may be near the democracy end, another somewhere in the middle, and a third may be near the despotism end. Let's find out about despotism. This man makes it his job to study these things.
Well, for one thing, avoid the comfortable idea that the mere form of government can of itself safeguard a nation against despotism. Germany, under President Hindenburg, was a republic. And yet in this republic, an aggressive despotism took root and flourished under Adolf Hitler.
A careful observer can use a respect scale to find how many citizens get an even break. As a community moves towards despotism, respect is restricted to fewer people. A community is low on a respect scale if common courtesy is withheld from large groups of people on account of their political attitudes.
This weekend, a few troublemakers turned a peaceful protest against Wall Street greed into a violent burst of chaos. The troublemakers carried pepper spray and guns and were wearing badges. This is just a story of a few cops being tougher than they had to be, and yeah, technically breaking some laws. And cops know they can always get away with that. American police know that no mayor and no police chief is ever going to call them on just being what they think of as a little too tough. Every day in America, police are too tough. Every day in America, police cross the line and abuse citizens. Every day in America, police get away with that. White America was shocked at what they saw police doing to Rodney King. Black America would have loved to have been shocked by what they saw police do to Rodney King, but Black America only could have been shocked if what the police did to Rodney King was something completely alien to their community experience, was something they couldn't imagine the police doing in their community. There's a Rodney King every day in this country, and Black America has always known that. They know just how much assault and battery their department will let them commit. They know just how many false arrests their department will let them do. They know just how much latitude their department gives them on abusing citizens. They do it because they know they can. They do it because they know they will get away with it. None of them will be charged with the assaults and batteries that they committed. None of them will be charged with the false arrests. None of them will lose a day's pay.
This July, we reported to you on the brutal death of Kelly Thomas. He was a 37-year-old schizophrenic homeless man who found himself face-to-face with a few Fullerton, California cops after they suspected that he was vandalizing cars. Thomas was tased at least six times, hogtied, and beaten by several police officers, ultimately putting him in a coma. It's an incident that was so horrific that even bystanders couldn't believe what they had just seen.
Kelly Thomas probably could have been more cooperative when Fullerton police officer Manny Ramos told him to put his feet out in front of him and his hands on his knees. But Thomas never threatens Ramos. He never shows any signs of aggression against the officer. It is Ramos who clearly and explicitly prepares to beat Thomas.
No, keep my fist. Yeah, what about him?
Start punching, dude.
You don't fucking stop this. Sucks.
Well, hey, I'm sick of playing games. Would you just fucking... All right.
Within minutes, the beating begins. First, with a baton to the legs. Then Thomas tries to run. The surveillance camera loses track of him momentarily. And when it finds him again, Ramos and another cop, Jay Cicinelli, are on top of him. At this point, Thomas can be heard surrendering, but it doesn't help him.
Okay, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, dude.
Okay. More police arrive and immediately join in the beating. There are six officers in all.
I'm sorry, dude. Please. Please.
Take the guy, dude. I'm sorry.
Here, I saw two cops on top of a homeless guy right here that I know, and they were pretty much beating him up, telling him to stop resisting, and then more police came and they started beating him with a flashlight, backup flashlight in the back of his head, and he wasn't moving around at all, but more came and they started tasering him, and it was just a horrible sight. I don't know really what to tell you.
What were the police saying?
The police were saying, quit resisting, quit moving, quit resisting arrest, you know, quit resisting. And the guy wasn't moving, had his arm in front of him, and his head was down already, and he wasn't moving at all. And they just kept going. They just kept
beating. Did you see him make any motion, even a defensive motion?
No, he was yelling, but that was the it.
Yelling what?
He was yelling, Dad, Dad, because they were beating him so bad. You know, he was yelling for his dad, and yeah, it was terrible, dude.
Do you think that the police were angry?
It didn't seem like they were angry. It seemed like they had a vengeance, and I don't know what for, but they were letting it out on him. And I don't know.
Well, so, were they doing this calmly, or were
no.
they?
It was erratic. There were so many people on top of him, and I mean, at a certain point, it was crazy. It was like a piranha.
Did it stop and start again? Or
no, it was just constant. It was constant.
And what did anything happen that finally brought it to an end?
Yeah, he stopped moving. He stopped talking, he stopped moving, he stopped everything. He wasn't even moving, but he was yelling for his dad, Dad, Dad.
So it was when he went silent.
And then when he went silent, everything stopped finally.
So as a former police officer, what is your hypothesis as to why this got to this extent?
It's very simple. He's in what officers call contempt of cop. Contempt of cop. That's what police officers use amongst themselves. He didn't do what they wanted. He didn't follow their program. So they bullied him. Under color of authority is what they did.
So your hypothesis is that his resisting makes them angry?
It made them very angry. It made them very angry. It's very evident from what they did. They didn't follow the procedures. They didn't follow procedures at all on how to arrest somebody.
After considering all of the law and all of the evidence in this case, I'm charging Officer Manuel Ramos with second-degree murder. One felony count of second-degree murder. And I'm also charging Officer Ramos with one felony count of involuntary manslaughter. If convicted, he faces a maximum sentence of 15 years to life in state prison. Corporal Jay Cicinelli is charged with one felony count of involuntary manslaughter and one felony count of the use of excessive force. If convicted, he faces a maximum sentence of 4 years in state prison.
The mother of a woodcarver killed by a Seattle police officer will get $1.5 million. It's a settlement that some say happened in record time. King 5's Owen Lay has been following the story since it broke and is live to explain what the deal means. Owen?
Yeah, attorneys for the Williams family say sometimes police shooting cases can take more than a decade to resolve. They believe this case settled quickly because both the police department and the family agree what happened at this intersection was wrong.
A man was shot to death by a police officer because he was allegedly wielding a knife. Well, it turns out he wasn't wielding a knife. He had a knife and he was using it to whittle. And
not exactly a big knife either.
He wasn't even actually, from what I understand, not even whittling at the time. The knife was apparently closed. And so this cop gets out of his car, and the video footage has now been posted over at freetalklive.com. You can't actually see him put bullets in this man, but you see him walking off the screen. You hear the audio of what is happening, and he basically tells the guy to drop the knife. And because he doesn't, after he's told to, like, two or three more times, literally, it's a span of 7 seconds between when the cop gives him the first order to drop the knife and riddles him with bullets. Now, nobody...
Turns out the guy has, he's partially deaf and has
headphones in.
Headphones in.
So you see that some adults there.
I had this really uncomfortable feeling in the pit of my stomach as I was thinking to myself, how did America transform itself from being a truly free country with a servant government where our individual rights were protected by our Constitution to being a country that talked about being free but really wasn't? The change started when the Federal Reserve came into existence and America adopted one of the major planks of the Communist Manifesto by bringing to America this central bank. The year was 1913. Woodrow Wilson was president, and powerful banking interests, who had been trying for years, finally achieved their long-term goal of a silent coup d'etat by taking control of the American government. The first thing they did to accomplish their takeover was convince Secretary of State Philander Knox to lie to the American people and tell them that the 16th Amendment, the Income Tax Amendment, had been legally ratified by the states when it was not. The bankers knew that this tax would ultimately end up in their pockets. Because of this fraud, the American people were led to believe there was now a tax on their labor. Congress and the president are completely aware of this fraud, and it was even cited in a recent court case. That very same year, the bankers committed their second and by far the most diabolical fraud ever perpetrated on the American people, by bribing senators to pass the Federal Reserve Act without the required constitutional amendment.
All in favor say aye.
They did this during Christmas vacation, when many senators were home celebrating the holidays with their families. And that's how the unconstitutional Federal Reserve Act came into being. They were very clever, and they understood that whoever issued the money for America would control the government. The bankers won, and the American people lost, because most politicians will sell their soul for a dollar. And now the Federal Reserve could issue dollars legally. As Mayor Rothschild said, "Give me control of a nation's money supply, and I care not who makes its laws." He knew that he and the other bankers would now control the laws of the nation. Government gave these bankers one of its most important powers, and now had to borrow money from them and pay interest to finance the government. So the American people were forced to lower their standard of living and pay a graduated income tax to the government, just so the government could give these bankers more profits. President Woodrow Wilson, who signed the Federal Reserve Act into law, later said, in regret, "I am a most unhappy man. I have unwittingly ruined my country. A great industrial nation is now controlled by its system of credit. We are no longer a government by free opinion, no longer a government by conviction and the vote of the majority, but a government by the opinion and duress of a small group of dominant men."
The Federal Reserve was created by Congress in 1913, and it was entrusted with the power, granted originally to the Congress by the U.S. Constitution, to coin money and regulate the value thereof.
So what is a central bank? A central bank is an institution that produces the currency of an entire nation. Based on historical precedent, two specific powers are inherent in central banking practice: the control of interest rates and the control of the money supply, or inflation. The central bank does not simply supply a government's economy with money, it loans it to them at interest. Then, through the use of increasing and decreasing the supply of money, the central bank regulates the value of the currency being issued. It is critical to understand that the entire structure of this system can only produce one thing in the long run: debt. It doesn't take a lot of ingenuity to figure this scam out. For every single dollar produced by the central bank is loaned at interest. That means every single dollar produced is actually the dollar plus a certain percent of debt based on that dollar. And since the central bank has the monopoly over the production of the currency for the entire country, and they loan each dollar out with immediate debt attached to it, where does the money to pay for the debt come from? It can only come from the central bank again, which means the central bank has to perpetually increase its money supply to temporarily cover the outstanding debt created, which in turn, since that new money is loaned out at interest as well, creates even more debt. The end result of this system without fail is slavery, for it is impossible for the government and thus the public to ever come out of the self-generating debt. The founding fathers of this country were well aware of this.
The reason they made it independent was they didn't trust the government not to manipulate it. But you can't trust the government, that's for sure, but you can't trust anybody with unaccountable power. So you have the same problem. And I think what it really comes down to is anytime you have unaccountable power, then you have a greater range for misbehavior, a greater range for mistakes that go unrecognized and uncorrected. And this is a cost for the system. And it becomes an even greater cost if the currency is a fiat currency that itself is not limited by some amount of precious metal, gold or silver, or limited in some way. When the currency becomes essentially unlimited by anything except the need to print it.
And now you have this Federal Reserve System, which then in 1913 got the right to create money for the government, when before that the government created its own money. Now the government, when it needed money, had to borrow it from this private bank called the Federal Reserve, which is a private bank owned by individuals, incorporated in Delaware.
Certainly over the course of its history, the Federal Reserve has caused a lot of problems. For example, right after it was created, it caused the Great Depression. It failed in its responsibility to be the lender of last resort to the banks. And when the banks were failing because of runs on the banks, and the inability to call in loans fast enough to pay off depositors, it was a responsibility of the Federal Reserve to be to get up carloads of cash and rush over to the bank and deliver it so they could pay off the customers and stop the runs. And as the banks failed, the money supply shrank. You know, every time a bank failed, in those days, there was no FDIC, no guaranteed deposits. So when a bank failed, the money supply shrank by the amount of the deposits in the bank. So there were a lot of bank failures, so the money supply was shrinking. And the Federal Reserve did take expansionary actions. They just never took them enough to offset the shrinkage. Well, if the supply of money shrinks, you can't maintain the same level of purchases and employment. And so when you shrink the supply of money, you shrink sales, you shrink employment, you get unemployment, you get falling gross national product. And that's what happened. And the entire decade of the 30s was troubles, serious troubles for people whose whole lives were disrupted. And it was because the Fed failed to do what it was established for.
Now, the government borrows money from them to fund the government. Then the government says, well, we have to pay these people interest. How are we going to pay them interest? Let's impose a tax on the labor of the American people, which never existed before, to pay the interest of the bankers. And so now what happens is that in 35, I believe it was, Social Security started. And they gave Social Security cards, said not to be used for identification, the Social Security number right on the card, right? And through Social Security, they started deducting money out of your paycheck. That was the first time they were ever could take money out of your paycheck, because people agreed to it because they thought it was going to their retirement fund. And so then when they instituted the income tax again, they started taking money out of your paycheck because Social Security could do it.
Whenever America decided that they would accept the Federal Reserve system, and whenever they decided that they would allow a private cartel of international bankers control the economic wherewithal of the United States, America left sound money principles that had guided it from its very inception. The founders were absolutely crystal clear that America must retain sound money principles, gold and silver backed currency and exchange. This fiat money supply, this Federal Reserve dominated money system that we have today is responsible for virtually every economic downturn and every recessionary period, including the Great Depression and the recession that we are now in today.
I had a friend, Nick Rockefeller, okay, who was one of the Rockefeller family, and he, when I was running for governor in Nevada, he came to me, introduced himself to me through an attorney, and we became friends. We started talking about things, and I learned an awful lot from Mr. Rockefeller. And one of the things that we used to talk about was the ultimate plan of the banking industry, what they wanted to accomplish. And the goals of the banking industry, not just the Federal Reserve System, but the private banks in Germany and England, all over Italy, all over the world, they all work together. They're all central banks. And they're all part of the Communist Manifesto. You know, central banking is one of the major planks of the Communist Manifesto. We talk about America being a capitalistic country, but yet at the same time we have a central bank that plans everything for us, right? And the graduated income tax is another plank of the Communist Manifesto, right? So right there you have two major planks of the Communist Manifesto that have been brought in because of the Federal Reserve System, okay? So the ultimate goal that these people have in mind is the goal to create a one-world government.
Well, government is good, right? It put an end to war. Well, it could put an end to war because you just only have one dictator. I think Adolf Hitler had that in mind. He wanted a world government too, with himself as the master leader.
Hitler had a dream that his big business should dominate the world. He called his dream the New Order. Foreign big business was weakened during the war, and today American big business is the strongest. And they have a dream: to dominate the world.
The desired goal eventually is to move the United States into world government. Not just any world government, but a world government based on the model of collectivism. In other words, big, powerful, centralized world government.
The goal of this manipulation, and has been for a very long time, is to get the world population, or that majority of it anyway, to see as a good idea, or the only option in given circumstances that are manipulated into place, the creation of a one world government to which nation states would be principalities, administrative units, a world central bank which would administer all financial transactions on the planet, a world currency which wouldn't be coins and notes, it would be merely electronic, cashless society, for which there are fundamental implications for freedom, as we'll see as we go along tonight. A world army under centralized control, with nation-state armies dismantled under the justification of seeking peace, and a microchipped population linked to a global computer, the latter of which sounds bizarre to many people on first hearing, except that we are ridiculously close to it and the technology already exists.
All of the great collectivists of history have had this unified global government based on the model of collectivism as their goal, and we fought against it until recently. Now we are actually the greatest advocates of it ourselves. We don't call it tyranny. We don't call it fascism or Nazism or communism. We have a better name for it. The name they have chosen is the New World Order.
I have in my possession a secret map made in Germany by Hitler's government, by the planners of the New World Order.
And the hope that each of us has to build a new world order.
I think even that does not describe why the world has changed so much and why the world has turned so much toward a new world order.
We have before us the opportunity to forge, for ourselves and for future generations, a new world order. When we are successful, and we will be, we have a real chance at this new world order.
George Bush has invoked a new world order.
Now we can see a new world coming into view. A world in which there is the very real prospect of a new world order. A world where the United Nations, freed from Cold War stalemate, is poised to fulfill the historic vision of its founders.
Are you optimistic a global system can happen, from what we've heard so far?
It could happen, and in fact it's in the works.
A new world is emerging. It is a new world order.
There's a need for a new world order, but it has different characteristics in different parts of the world.
So I think you need a new world order, that China has to be part of the process of creating it, and they have to buy in, they have to own it.
But today, with Asia already outproducing Europe, India and China are clearly becoming part of our new order.
We will have the kind of global governance that is necessary to ensure the stability and transparency of markets.
God is setting up a new world order, and his plan includes you.
The problem of the Bush presidency will be the emergence of a new international order.
Within the next 4 years, we will see the emergence of a new international order.
The beginning.
We've got to give them a stake creating the kind of world order that I think all of us would like to see.
I think its task will be to develop an overall strategy for America in this period, when really a new world order can be created. It's a great opportunity.
President Obama and British Prime Minister Gordon today calling for a new world order.
We may not see it this year, we may not see it next year, but they have opened up the idea of there being some form of other regulator across countries, and I think that's going to come
back. So is this some sort of new world order, which Gordon Brown kind of alluded to?
I think a new world order is emerging, and with it the foundations of a new and progressive era of international cooperation.
2009 is also the first year of global governance with the establishment of the G20 in the middle of the financial crisis. The climate conference in Copenhagen is another step towards the global management of our planet.
It is a big idea, a new world order.
The kaleidoscope has been shaken. The pieces are in flux. Soon they will settle again. Before they do, let us reorder this world around us.
The New World Order is a more palatable name for the Anglo-American world empire. It's the planetary domination of London, New York, Washington over the rest of the world. It's hard to get people to join that or think they have a part in it if you call it the Anglo-American world empire. If you call it the New World Order, then people in India or someplace like that or the European Union might think, well, there's something in that for us too. But that's not what it is. It's the Anglo-American New World Order. It's really the old world order. It's the British Empire morphing into the American Empire. The US-British world empire is what you're going to get.
For decades, the media denied it existed. But now they're saying, oh yes, there's going to be a global government, a new bank of the world, and we're going to pay our carbon taxes to it. What is it? It's nothing more than a private, hostile, corporate takeover of every sovereign nation on Earth.
I had planned another closing message, but I feel compelled to say what I'm about to say. Now, I risk sounding like a conspiracy theorist, but it's no longer a theory. What I'm about to say is fact. The secret organizations of the world power elite are no longer secret. They have planned and are now leading us into a one-world communist government. Money from our treasury is now being spent for this effort. We will have a new currency and a new constitution modeled on the Soviet Union's constitution. Our rights will not be inalienable, but they will be granted by government, who can also take them away. This is terrorism of the most worst kind, brought on you by our own government. The strongest, freest nation in the history of mankind will be averaged into world communism.
If it were a world government based on the principles of freedom and freedom of choice, freedom of culture, low intervention, if no intervention in the lives of normal human beings, it might be a wonderful thing, but that's not the kind of world government the left and the right have in mind. They're talking about total world government, with all major decisions being made at the top, and people at the bottom being essentially living in a feudalist society, just serfs and peasants, basically, in a high-tech feudalism.
Slavery has always existed in one form or another. There's different ways to have slavery. You can either get a bunch of henchmen, force a tribe into obeying you and being your slaves. That's a lot of force. But you have to feed them, etc. Or you can allow them to keep so much of their earnings for themselves, to maintain themselves, and take off all the rest to supply the elite and the structure of the system over them. But he says, we are now in the process of creating a more sophisticated form of slavery. In other words, the general public who would drift into the system and it become natural for them would never twig on that they were actually slaves. You tie that in with the institutions that the Huxleys and the Darwins belong to. The Royal Institute for International Affairs, which has branches in every country in the world, they set up the United Nations. They said in their own writings, from the earliest times to the present, the world they're bringing in is to be a world where everyone who is born, or would be allowed to be born, would be born to serve the state.
In April of 1945, at the Presidio Naval Base in San Francisco, the United Nations was founded by the victors of World War II. The United Nations complex was then built in New York City on land donated by John D. Rockefeller.
The same financial cartel are the most influential people in the establishment of the United Nations, which is being offered to the people of the world as a means of preserving the peace and protecting the interest of the common man. The same kind of a charade is going on there. Remember that the United Nations land was donated by the Rockefellers. Why did they do that? Why did the Rockefellers donate land, for example, to a Sloan Kettering Institute in New York, and then put three of their men on the board of directors? Why did they donate money for this great institution and that one, and then load up the board of directors with their people? Why do they do that? It's because they want something. But it's not something that the average person is going to learn about by reading the newspapers. So the United Nations is a creation of these same people that created the Federal Reserve System.
The original charter for the United Nations was drafted in San Francisco in 1945, and the United States became a permanent member of the Security Council, along with France, the United Kingdom, the Soviet Union, and the Republic of China. The process by which other nations' belief systems could be used to erode and eviscerate our Constitution and Bill of Rights had taken a giant leap forward.
Anybody who would read the UN documents with just as much care as they would read a used car sales contract, they would never sign on to the system. For example, the draft covenant for human rights, for example, they list all of these wonderful privileges and rights which all mankind is going to have under the UN. And they're all there, you know, freedom of speech, religion, peaceful assembly, and all of these good things. Oh, you're not going to find the right to bear arms there, by the way. They don't have that one there. But all the others they've got listed. You say, well, okay, so all of these rights are guaranteed, right, by the UN. But continue reading, my friend, and you find out that in every case there's a clause that follows it and says, you may have this right, freedom of speech, for example, except as may be provided for by law. Well, what does that mean? That means you've got these rights until we pass a law that says you don't have these rights anymore. Or we say you can have these rights under some conditions and no, not other conditions. Every one of these so-called rights have that kind of a little gimmick following them, except as may be provided for by law, which means you haven't got them at all. You'll find those same clauses in the Soviet Constitution and in all of these totalitarian systems. They sound good to a casual reader, but when you really look at them carefully and read the fine print, you would never sign the contract.
This is for a very simple reason. If you are the few and you want to control the many, you have to centralize decision making. Because the more diversity of decision making you have, the less control you have over those decisions. So what you want is the decisions made by as few people as possible, so you have control over those decisions. Thus, the great buzz phrase in global politics is now international law. What is international law? It is a law that everyone on the planet has to obey. Orgasmic and indeed essential for anyone who wants a global dictatorship. Laws that everyone on the planet has to obey.
Every country was basically citing the same laws, and had been in my whole life, at the same time that affected their societies. Laws were introduced and bills were introduced unbeknownst to the people in those countries that it was being introduced in their neighboring countries or even across the water somewhere at the same time. I realized there was already a governmental control, obviously, that coordinated all of this, and it led me into the United Nations. For every single department of government you have on a federal, local, county, state, provincial level, the United Nations had an equivalent department to deal with everything. It was already set up, in fact, to be global government. H.G. Wells said at the League of Nations, which was the embryo for the United Nations, he said, this is the nucleus of the world governments, when eventually all laws will come from there, be passed and signed into law by treaty of all the member countries. Eventually, we won't even have to go through the farce, and that's what it is, of voting in parties or candidates, because in the latter part of the 20th century and now into the 21st century, we're being trained rather obviously to simply accept rule by experts, rule by scientists, rule by professionals, and that's what they mean when they call governance. That's the term used.
One of the ways it will drive the change is through global governance and global agreements.
And so what we're facing today is a United Nations that has been sold to the average person of the world who wants peace. They're tired of war. They don't want the threat of war, atomic warfare, biological warfare. They don't want terrorism. They don't want crime. They don't want pornography. They don't want all of these bad things. And so they're told that the United Nations, if we just give it more power, more money, more military, more police, more rules, more laws, more regulations, that somehow they're going to take care of all of that for us. And the truth of the matter is, we're all going to wind up in a universal prison.
You're free, and freedom is beautiful. And, you know, it'll take time to restore chaos and order, but we're order out of chaos, but we will.
They believe if you can cause enough pain and wars and suffering, then out of the ashes of that will emerge their solution to this problem that they created, which is their solution would be oneness, one world, everything. It's also known as the Hegelian dialectic, where you set up the thesis, you also set up the antithesis, so that you can offer your synthesis to the very problem and opposition that you created in the first place.
I mean, that's exactly what these people even talk about. It's the Hegelian dialect. Problem, reaction, solution
is the term I coined to describe a system whereby you create the problem. 9/11 is a classic. You don't even need a real problem. There is a version of this which I call no problem reaction solution, like weapons of mass destruction in Iraq. You only need the perception of a problem. You get people to believe there's a problem, and a problem needs a solution.
You then generate your desired reaction, which is often, this is unacceptable, what are you going to do about it?
And you go towards something that they already set up for you from the beginning.
Good morning, America. I'm Diane Sawyer.
And I'm Charles Gibson. Partners in crime, we are right here in our usual host.
Partners in crime. We want to tell you what we know as we know it. We just got a report in that there's been some sort of explosion at the World Trade Center in New York.
Holy shit, man. That's the other building. That's terrorists. That's terrorists, bro.
Oh my God.
That's fucking terrorists.
What do we do?
That's terrorists.
Good evening. Today, our fellow citizens, our way of life, our very freedom came under attack in a series of deliberate and deadly terrorist acts. The victims were in airplanes or in their offices, secretaries, businessmen and women, military and federal workers, moms and dads, friends and neighbors. Thousands of lives were suddenly ended by evil, despicable acts of terror. The pictures of airplanes flying into buildings, fires burning, huge structures collapsing, have filled us with disbelief, terrible sadness, and a quiet, unyielding anger. These acts of mass murder were intended to frighten our nation into chaos and retreat.
Global terrorism, the horror. Terrorism, terrorists. Terrorists, 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 the terrorists. Terrorists, terrorists, terrorism. September 11th, global terrorism, terrorism. Terrorism. September 11th, world terrorism, terrorism. Terrorism, 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 terrorist. September 11th, threat of global terrorism, terrorism, terrorist. Global terrorism, terrorism, terrorism. September 11th, 2001, global terrorism. Terrorists, global terrorism, terrorism, terrorists, September 11th, terror.
The Patriot Act was created after 9/11. It allows federal agents to investigate suspected cases of terrorism swiftly in order to better protect our country.
I commend the House and Senate for the hard work they put into this legislation. Members of Congress and their staffs spent long nights and weekends to get this important bill to my desk.
Congress had been evacuated because of the anthrax scare, and most of us were hanging around the lawn of the Capitol. We're really out of touch. Yet they felt some desire to rush this bill through.
Investigators still don't know where it came from, but the anthrax that killed two Washington postal workers seems to have the hallmarks of a sophisticated weapon built by someone who knows how to deliver a lethal blow.
Somebody knew exactly what they were doing.
More than two dozen staffers tested positive for exposure, but not infection, after the anthrax-laced letter was opened in Senator Daschle's office.
Give us a weekend to read it, and let's take it up Monday morning. Hey, I'll come in and vote at 7 o'clock on Monday morning if it's that urgent.
When the Patriot Act was first sent to the Congress by the Bush administration, it came with a request that we hold no hearings on it so that there would be no public input or public discourse.
That might have even been somewhat acceptable had it been the bill that was considered by and adopted unanimously by the committee, but it wasn't.
We came up with a draft of the bill that that did have very, very broad support across the Judiciary Committee. Unfortunately, it was then changed in a last-minute draft before it came up on the floor.
Sometime very late in the evening after midnight, the John Ashcroft version, Bush White House version, was substituted.
The bill was printed at 3:45 a.m. the morning before the vote on the House floor. You tell me how many of the 435 members of Congress had a chance between 3:45 a.m. and 11 a.m. to read a bill that was 345 pages long.
No member of Congress read this legislation before his vote on it. Not a one.
This is still warm. It just came off the Xerox machine. This isn't the bill that was adopted by a unanimous 36 vote majority of Democrats and Republicans of the Judiciary Committee. These are critical issues. This is what we're fighting for. These are our civil liberties.
To those who scare peace-loving people with phantoms of lost liberty, my message is this: your tactics only aid terrorists.
John Ashcroft told the House Judiciary Committee and the Senate Judiciary Committee the Patriot Act was so important that they didn't have time to read the statute before they could vote on it. Congress said, forget about it. The times are too tough. It's too difficult. We don't want another 9/11. Here's the bargain. Give me your freedom and I'll keep you safe. It has never worked. It makes us less free and unsafe.
During the next few minutes, I want to update you on the progress we are making in our war against terror and to propose sweeping changes that will strengthen our homeland against the ongoing threat of terrorist attacks. Tonight, I propose a permanent cabinet-level Department of Homeland Security to unite essential agencies that must work more closely together, among them the Coast Guard, the Border Patrol, the Customs Service, immigration officials, the Transportation Security Administration, and the Federal Emergency Management Agency. Employees of this new agency will come to work every morning, knowing their most important job is to protect their fellow citizens. The Department of Homeland Security will be charged with four primary tasks. This new agency will control our borders and prevent terrorists and explosives from entering our country. It will work with state and local authorities to respond quickly and effectively to emergencies. It will bring together our best scientists to develop technologies that detect biological, chemical, and nuclear weapons, and to discover the drugs and treatments to best protect our citizens. And this new department will review intelligence and law enforcement information from all agencies of government and produce a single daily picture of threats against our homeland. Analysts will be responsible for imagining the worst and planning to counter it.
Real
individual freedoms are eaten up a little at a time, while government controls are slipped on, while the real power is collected into a few hands. Where government is not limited, no man is free. Change limited government to unlimited government, and our rights would be only what the master planners say they are. No longer the servant of the people, government would be the master of the people. That's the way to change what we have. Take all power and all freedoms away from the people and collect everything into the hands of one small group with absolute power.
The Patriot Act was already written, waiting on the shelf, and it was passed, I think, within 2 days of 9/11. If you look at the massive document, it obviously wasn't written overnight. So what they've done is to tell us that they can't protect Americans from terrorism unless they infringe our civil liberties.
The Patriot Act and all of these other pieces of legislation are supposed to protect our freedom from terrorists or somebody. But when you look at the essence of these pieces of legislation, they take our freedom away. And it just doesn't make sense that you accomplish your objective by working against it.
The Patriot Act is a apparent response to 9/11, but in fact was a long-planned imposition of government control over the people. On the basis of we must stop the terrorists, they've introduced legislation designed to stop the people.
The Patriot Act is pointed at the American people. We are the target. It is designed to destroy the Bill of Rights and the Constitution. It is designed to destroy our due process. The Patriot Act states in Section 802 that terrorism isn't just bombing things or shooting people anymore, but any action that violates any federal or state law. Literally, jaywalking is terrorism under Section 802 of the Patriot Act. The Patriot Act is pointed at the men and women of the United States. It is designed to destroy our due process.
That the people have been fooled, duped, made to think that they have to buy security by giving up their constitutional rights. This is untrue. This is false. You do not have to give up your constitutional rights in order to be safe. Indeed, if you give up your constitutional rights, you cannot be safe. You will not be safe. Your government can do far worse things to you than any terrorist. Has far more power over you. The only thing that mitigates that power and gives you a shield of protection are your civil liberties. And so if you lose your civil liberties in order to be safe from terrorists, you will be the most unsafe people on the face of the earth.
In my opinion, I think what has happened here is, you know, the American people tend to not really pay all that much attention to our government unless our government really overreaches its bounds. And so for years and years and years, the federal government has continued to step more and more into areas where they don't belong. They've reached their dirty little fingers into areas where they don't belong. But what they've done to the American people is they've done it, or they've served it to the American people a thimbleful at a time. They've given it to them a little bit more and a little bit more. And it looks like maybe when served a thimbleful at a time, the American people are a lot more likely to go ahead and receive it or swallow it, so to speak.
Today, let's visit the airport of a large city. This is the main building of the airport. It's called the Terminal Building. At this airport, many planes come and go every day.
Announcing the departure of Flight 609, now loading at gate 1. Flight 609, now loading at gate 1. Have your tickets ready, please.
Alongside problem reaction solution comes the totalitarian tiptoe, as I call it. This works like this. You know you're going there from the start. But you know if you go there in big leaps, the change is going to be so vast that people are going to kind of look up from the television game show and go, hold on, honey, what's going on? Sorry, honey, I thought you were asleep. I was. Lift their head from the game show And they're going to say, what's going on? So they do it like that. They go from A to B, and then to D, and then maybe to E. They go as quickly as they can and as far as they can with each step, but not so far that they get a big public reaction.
What they've done is they've decided to go ahead and just really, instead of trying to serve up their encroachments a thimbleful at a time, they're trying to serve it to the American people in 5-gallon buckets. Well, when the federal government oversteps its bounds in 5-gallon buckets, the American people wake up.
It happened at Armstrong International Airport in New Orleans. 6-year-old Anna Drexel is patted down by a TSA agent. The gloved agent explaining what she's doing at each step. Patting down her sides, her waistband, and bottom. Afterwards, her mother says little Anna cried, wondering what she'd done wrong.
TSA is investigating this video of a 3-year-old boy in a wheelchair being patted down at airport security. The boy was wearing a leg cast. He was being examined at Chicago's O'Hare Airport. We don't know when this happened, but the video was uploaded this weekend. The video seems to be shot by the boy's father.
More complaints of absurd pat-downs by the TSA. This time the air traveler isn't a kid, but an elderly woman who was forced to remove her adult diaper. A Florida woman says security agents asked her 95-year-old mother, who is in a wheelchair, to remove her diaper so they could complete a full search.
Well, the TSA is under fire tonight after an agent at the Lihue Airport told a breastfeeding mother she could not board a flight to Maui with her breast pump until it was filled with milk.
The TSA agent ordered her to fill her breast pump with milk in order to get through security with the equipment. The high school vice principal was forced to pump her breasts in a busy public restroom at the Lihue Airport.
Tonight we're hearing about another security pat-down horror story at Charlotte Douglas International Airport. This time it's from a local flight attendant and cancer survivor who says she was forced to show her prosthetic breasts during a pat-down. Her story is part of a growing backlash against intrusive new security measures at our nation's airports, and her story is also all new tonight at 11 o'clock.
If it looks like a duck, quacks like a duck, and, well, probably is a duck. But that is not the case for some House GOP members when it comes to TSA officers. Outraged over recent strip searches of the elderly and pat-downs of toddlers, they are backing a bill that would ban TSA officers from using the title officer, wearing a badge, or wearing uniforms resembling those of police officers. It's called the Stop TSA's Reach-In Policy Act, or the STRIP Act.
They are not officers. They are not federal law enforcement officers. They do not get any federal law enforcement officer training. They are not eligible for those benefits. And even though they have gone to wearing these uniforms, which they did this through administrative rulemaking, not through coming to Congress, they wear the uniforms, they wear the badge. We still have had over 25,000 breaches. And what we are saying is, look, these are screeners. You have reclassified their job title to say officers. You did that administratively. They should go back to being screeners and focus on protecting the flying public, not to overreaching their authority because they're wearing a law enforcement uniform and a badge. They advertise for screeners on pizza boxes and at discount gas stations in the Washington, D.C. area.
Right.
They do not have to go through this law enforcement training. Maybe they should stop impersonating federal law enforcement officers and stop the overreach.
It was this past Sunday night here at LAX about 7:30, probably crowded because a lot of people were coming home from the New Year's holiday, when suddenly a man starts acting strangely. He starts saying, I'm God, I'm in charge. LAX police and arrest that man, and he turns out to be a TSA agent. They are the first line of defense in airport security, Transportation Security Administration agents. But there have been two troubling incidents involving LAX TSA agents recently. A source tells Channel 4 News a TSA agent was arrested on January 3rd here at Terminal 1 at LAX. He'd just gotten off duty and was behaving erratically, saying, I am God, I'm in charge. The agent was arrested under the welfare code and could have been hospitalized in protective custody for up to 72 hours. Meanwhile, a TSA internal affairs investigation turned up evidence of LAX TSA agents using drugs at an after-hours party.
The investigation turned on a bungled drug shipment that led to an arrest and information that TSA screeners were taking bribes to let parcels of cocaine, meth, and marijuana through security.
The 43-year-old TSA agent pleaded guilty to conspiracy to defraud the United States for using her unique role as a behavior detection officer to escort a local drug dealer as he carried a large amount of cash through security at Buffalo Niagara International Airport.
What? Not again. Oh yeah, again. TSA agents accused of stealing tens of thousands of dollars from airline passengers' checked baggage, but this time at JFK. So far, $39,980 has been recovered.
Police say that a man wearing a TSA uniform flashed a badge to a woman in Manassas and then sexually assaulted her. They say that man is 52-year-old TSA employee Harold Rodman.
A TSA agent under arrest charged with lewd and lascivious molestation of a minor. Police say he tried to keep a girl as a sex slave.
Police arrested 57-year-old Charles Bennett after a 15-year-old reported him to police.
TSA worker at Logan Airport arrested, accused of raping a 14-year-old girl, and there is more.
The TSA themselves say it's perfectly fine to videotape their checkpoints.
Really?
This gentleman tells, yes,
really?
On their website.
Sir?
I have quoted to him, my standard operating procedure says specifically, there are no photographs permitted to be taken of the screening process.
Could I see it?
No, you cannot.
So there's a secret rule?
No, there isn't a secret rule. I know what it
okay,
is.
Sir?
I'm a terminal manager. It's my
okay, first of all, permission. You can't even tape in this building. You have to get permission from Terminal 4 to film in this building, number one. Number two, you can't double time. You can't tape their activities because we don't know who you are. We don't know what you are.
You have my ID. He's
that
run my permission.
And what does that mean? What does that mean, honestly?
I have no
absolutely,
ID.
Exactly. Not a damn thing. So this is a deal.
Then why did he ask for it?
You're going to stop it. You're going to rewind. From where you taping their activities, you're going to stop and you're going to delete all of that, then you can leave.
I'm not going to delete videotape.
You're not going to delete the videotape?
No,
are you sure about that? You sure that's what you want to do?
Sir,
you sure that's what you want to do? I'm just asking, are you sure that's what you want to do?
I have no desire to delete videotape because I'm being threatened.
No problem. You're not being threatened, you're going to be arrested.
That's not a threat.
It's my aunt's husband. We call him Theo. These are like my cousins and sobrinos and nephews. How you doing, sir?
Hello, I'm doing good. Turn it off.
What?
Turn it off.
Turn it on?
Turn it off.
Why?
Why? Because I'm going to deny you access otherwise. You can't be filming us. Turn it off.
That's not true, though. That's not true, sir.
Supervisor.
Sir, you know, sir, how long have you been working at TSA?
Supervisor.
Go on, I'll meet you guys inside.
This gentleman's refusing to turn it.
Sir, I'm doing a video and he's
going inside. Go ahead. Yeah, what? You can't tape anything he's doing.
No, that's not true, sir. Are you a supervisor?
I'm not bothered with you.
Are you a supervisor?
Well, I haven't verified his stuff yet. He's refusing to turn his filmings.
Sir, you're going to give your stuff away?
Give my stuff where?
He needs your ID.
Yeah, I give it to him. He has my ID.
Oh, so
he's filming the camera.
He just can't film you on his phone. Oh, he turned it off. We can get the MR. I mean, that's what.
Sir, the policy of TSA is you are allowed to record on the checkpoint.
No,
is that not correct?
You're not correct.
I'm not correct. So why does it say that on the TSA website?
I don't know, but you're going to talk to me. We'll take care of that part.
All right.
Well, that was a little adventure. I mean, I was detained. My aunt was detained. The rest of the Colombians were freaking out. And I think it's time for a beer, man. I haven't had a beer in 2 days. So I'm going to have one right now.
There's a dangerous new weapon on the streets. It's scaring police officers across the country. More and more people are carrying it as it becomes cheaper and more available every day. That weapon is the camera.
Turn it off.
I'm not shutting it off, officer.
Well, you're going to jail.
Get off the motorcycle. State police.
Giving a written warning.
You keep filming me, I'm going to take it from you. Understand?
I'm not putting the camera down until you reveal. We're rolling, bud. We're rolling. You hit me.
You can't take pictures on federal property.
Why not?
You need to. That's the law.
Turn the camera off.
No, sir.
Turn the camera off.
No, sir.
You want to go to jail?
Got off. I don't want that. Get that away from my face, sir.
I'm not going to shut it off.
You got any ID on you?
I don't.
Turn the camera away.
No, no, sir. No? You're a public officer.
Yes, I am.
So I have the right to videotape you.
You can just turn that off.
Why?
Because I asked you to.
There's no law against it.
Just turn it off.
I'll put it down here.
But turn it off.
Sir, we're not
gonna, I asked you to turn it off.
I'm not going to turn it off.
Sir,
you're a public officer.
You're a public officer on the public street.
Okay, let's go on down the road then. What's the deal?
Going down the road where?
I just asked you not to do that, okay? I don't want a picture taken.
Well, sir, you're a public officer.
That's fine. You bet.
Please don't touch our camera.
Now talk to me.
Please don't touch our camera, sir. Please don't do that.
You guys are going to have to cooperate with me.
Well, we're cooperating.
There's nothing wrong with filming.
Turn that off.
Sir, we're not going to turn it off.
This is not Nazi Germany. This is not Communist Russia. This is United States of America.
Turn that off. Turn it off.
No, sir. Sir, it's a public street.
Yeah, he does.
It's a private street, sir. This is a private camera. This is a private
camera. I'm asking you, I do not want to be photographed right now, so turn it off.
Sir, you're in a public street. This is a public sidewalk.
Turn it off.
And this is a private camera. You cannot touch this camera.
I'm telling you, turn it off.
What have I done that is breaking the law?
Is that on audio?
Yeah, it's video.
It's
audio,
it's
video.
A recording video also?
Yeah.
And sound?
Yeah, video and
sound.
Okay,
you need to hand me your camera.
How come?
You need to hand me your camera.
Okay.
I'm telling you, you can't videotape and record our voice without our permission. And if you're doing it, we're going to arrest you.
I don't want to get arrested.
Well, then turn it off.
You guys need something?
This is my front yard. I'm just recording what you're doing. It's my right.
Actually, not from the sidewalk.
This is my yard.
You're not listening to our orders right now. We don't feel safe with you standing behind us. You're not moving even a foot further back. You're gonna be.
Do you want me to move a foot further back?
You're gonna be under arrest. I already warned you.
I will move a foot further back. I'm not going to go inside my house. I feel like I need the fresh air right now. I'm gonna back up.
You know what? You're gonna go to jail. That's just not right.
What is it? Come on.
No. Stay right here.
I'm sorry. I'm
observing what they're doing and they're arresting me. I don't understand what's going on. I did nothing.
It's a debate going on here in the Bay Area and in cities across the country. Should people be allowed to videotape cops on the job? Well, tonight a new court ruling may bring an end to that argument. 10 News reporter Adam Freeman showing us how it gives you the freedom to keep filming.
Hi, how you doing?
Good. How you doing, Ian?
It's happened to a college student in Tarpon Springs.
What the Tarpon Springs police did was wrong.
To a homeowner in New York.
You're not listening to our orders right now.
Even a news photographer.
Put it down. You're under arrest.
All arrested for simply videotaping police on duty. Only problem? It's not illegal. A U.S. Court of Appeals in Boston has now confirmed that with a ruling saying filming cops in a public place is your choice, protected by the First Amendment, regardless of what an officer tells you.
It was stunning video posted on the internet for all to see, and it came with a charge that police masqueraded as protesters at this week's Montebello summit to incite violence. Tonight, an equally stunning admission from Quebec's provincial police.
Contrary to media reports, the protest was peaceful and almost carnival-like, but the police ramped up their presence as if they were expecting a riot. After about 3 hours, someone at the back of the protest started throwing rocks and bottles towards the front line. I saw one protester get hit in the head with a rock. Unlike other reporters, I didn't have a helmet or gas mask for protection, so I decided to move to the back of the protest and do some follow-up interviews. That's when I happened upon this scene.
No. Put the rock down, man. Put the rock down. Put the rock down. This is our line. Get out of town. Cops out of town.
Communications, Energy, and Paper Workers Union President Dave Coles was confronting these three masked men with rocks and bottles and accusing them of being police officers. You can see from this footage that they were intent on starting a riot. Watch as the gloved hand of one of these provocateurs hits a member of the riot squad in the face mask. Now watch as he changes hands with the rock and then bangs it into a riot shield. These masked men were attempting to violently disrupt an otherwise peaceful protest. They were breaking the law and violating the constitutionally guaranteed rights of the protesters. The whole scene was surreal. I knew Dave Coles had managed to reveal the face of one of the provocateurs, but I didn't have footage of the other two. I changed roles from independent journalist to citizen on patrol and made sure I captured a second face. The action of these three masked men and the reaction of the riot squad was highly suspect, but ultimately it was the matching boots that gave the provocateurs away. That night I posted the footage on YouTube. For the next 4 days, it was a national and international news story. The Sûreté de Québec denied any involvement, but on the fourth day, they finally admitted it was their officers.
As we confirmed yesterday, the three people in question were indeed Sûreté de Québec police officers performing their duties.
Well, in Montebello, Quebec in 2007, there was three police officers who were dressed as aggressive protesters with rocks in their hands, wearing masks, in an attempt to incite violence.
These three guys are cops, everybody!
George, as a representative of the Toronto Police, can you assure us that the Toronto Police Force will not engage in any provocateur agent activities at the G20 summit?
Security matters. I'm not at liberty to discuss those in an open format. Obviously, with these people coming to town, this is a huge international event. It puts Toronto on the global stage. We obviously have to take the steps that we deem necessary to provide that protection for them to visit Canada.
Billionaires are your enemies. Wall Street billionaires stole hundreds of millions of dollars from police pension funds. They're the ones who are the criminals. They get away with it, but they wear a suit and tie. We're not your enemies. You're not our enemies. You're our neighbors. It's the system that allows your retirement funds to be stolen from you, which is going to make it harder for your kids to go to college, to make their lives better than yours, the American dream. We're not your enemies, man. I got thousands of dollars in student debt. I didn't get a bailout. How is that fair? Some of your neighbors and friends have been foreclosed on. They didn't get a bailout. How is that fair? I'm just saying, I'm not your enemy. I don't want to do you harm. But I think we need to find our common ground here.
Open your bag.
I thought as long as he's not within the 5 meters, though, it's fine.
You don't get a choice. Get moving.
Where are you grabbing me, man?
Get moving.
In Canada, that's something that's...
Yeah, say Canada, right?
I just don't like to have my civil rights violated.
There's no civil rights here in this area. How many times you got to be told that?
That's on, but there are. That's within 5 years of the fence, there's no civil rights. That's what the legislation said on Monday.
If that was the rule, we'd all be behind the fence.
The investigation I'm reporting on today is the first of several public attempts to get to the bottom of exactly what happened here during the week of the summit, why it happened, and what can be done to ensure it never happens again. My investigation focused on the province's role in promoting what became known as the Secret Security Regulation, a little-known and widely misunderstood legal measure that was supposed to help the police keep the peace, but in my view, wound up contributing to massive violations of civil rights. Some people in the ministry were rightly concerned about the optics of using wartime legislation, but others saw the regulation as mere technicality. So the decision was made not to publicize it. Instead, they quietly handed the police extravagant, sweeping powers under 71-year-old law. Powers that would almost certainly be illegal and unconstitutional under the Charter of Rights and Freedoms. Little did they realize that once this powerful weapon was unleashed, it would be almost impossible to control. Reviving this dormant piece of legislation, coupled with the adoption of the regulation, created a legal landscape where people were detained by the police and compelled to identify themselves, answer questions, and submit to warrantless searches, even if they simply wanted to walk away. Apart from a coterie of senior officials in government and the Toronto Police Service, no one else was aware of the existence of this regulation or the fact that they would trigger what amounted to martial law in downtown Toronto. Police do not have the right to detain people arbitrarily and force them under threat of law to identify themselves and be searched on the spot. And for the citizens of Toronto, the days up to and including the weekend of the G20, we'll live in infamy as a time period where martial law set in the city of Toronto, leading to the most massive compromise of civil liberties in Canadian history. And we can never let that happen again.
The behavior of the police shows, again, the militarization of the police, because they were very aggressive toward people who weren't causing any trouble. And I believe the police were frankly disappointed that there wasn't more trouble for them to beat up on. And so they, on their own, went into neighborhoods with their new weapons or protest suppression systems, and just sort of arbitrarily abused people. So it's a further indication that the police agencies of the government are now separate from people that they're supposed to protect.
In commando practice, cadet officers learn how a group of men working as one can be an effective wedge between destructive mobs and the peaceful citizen and his property. He began to see the importance of prevention whenever possible. Prevention of accidents and prevention of crime. He had proved himself to be alert, willing to take orders and carry them out, and firm but courteous in his contacts with the public.
This is what a police officer used to be, and that's what I was on the city of Phoenix. I was a friend of the people. But today, this is what we have. This one is your enforcer, and he's enforcing the New World Order locally, state, and federally. I began to change. I began to see that I was part of a corrupt system, a very evil system, and I wasn't going to do it. When they gave me an immoral order or an unlawful order, I said, no, I won't do it. That was it for my career.
Later on.
life, you got out of the Marine Corps, you got into law enforcement. Is that when you started asking questions once you learned more about the civilian role?
Towards my end in law enforcement, when I started getting discouraged with it, yes. That's when I started quitting. But when you're younger and you're trying to achieve and you're, you know, you got all the fancy jewelry on and all the badge and the car with all the nice decals and lights and, you know, you're disillusioned by a lot of different things once reality hits. And just the way law enforcement's changed a lot, it's changing a lot.
How has it changed?
How people perceive law enforcement is more of an occupying army than somebody that's there to be part of that community and help that community.
Violence in society is not caused by the people. It's caused by the neglect of leadership. And the police are the number one cause of violence in society. They make the people jittery. They make the people insecure. Plus, if you look up what a police officer is in the Black's Law Dictionary, the only thing the police are supposed to be doing is keeping the peace. And they do not. So whose fault is it when you have violence in society? If you're paying taxes to have peace in society and moral justice, the police are supposed to be the epitome of morality. Our children are supposed to look at a police officer and see an example of what a citizen is. Now they fear them. So if our children don't even respect the police, how are they gonna respect the law?
You know, before, people knew the law enforcement officer that patrolled their neighborhood or could go down to the city police department and ask for help, where now it's more of a, you're making trouble for yourself by going to report a crime, or just the perception that people have of law enforcement. Now, don't get me wrong, there's some great cops out there, some of the best, and they're still there doing the job, and there's new one comes up there doing the job, but for the most part, it's treated like a occupying army. You're seeing a lot more of the training of putting distance between yourself and the people you're trying to protect.
Who was the first terrorist organization in the United States? Who?
Founding Fathers.
Founding Fathers. You mean Thomas Jefferson?
Oh, yeah.
You mean George Washington?
Oh, yeah.
Paul Revere?
Yeah.
These guys right here, let me ask you something. Did they try to scare people?
Oh, yeah.
They tried to intimidate the British. Did they use acts of violence? Your founding fathers, my founding fathers, were involved in acts of terrorism against British officials because they systematically had British officials assassinated. The guys who we call our founding fathers, George Washington, Mr. Honor, who cut down a cherry tree and admitted it, is the same guy who signed death orders, if you will, on members of the British government, the British Crown, who they wanted to eliminate because politically they had influence in certain pockets of the United States, at that time the 13 colonies, and they wanted to divide and conquer. See, this is reality. Yeah, they're terrorists, but the bottom line is to them, they are not. Now, why is that important to understand? Because they are as committed to their cause and to their way of life as you are yours. And they see you as being wrong.
To force their unpopular agenda upon the planet, the controllers are racing to complete the construction of their police state control grid. Borrowing from tactics used in the past by communist, fascist, and other totalitarian regimes, every form of classical textbook tyranny is now being implemented in the West. In the United States, the central government is federalizing local police.
State and local officers are in a great position to collect important information on terrorists and their allies. And the Terrorist Screening Center stands ready to help you.
This video, produced by Homeland Security, is required viewing for all departments in the U.S.
And with the teamwork of local, state, and federal law enforcement, we have an excellent opportunity to see the picture and solve the puzzle before these terrorists can strike again.
State, county, and city police now take their marching orders directly from DHS and FEMA. The videos and training manuals turn peace officers, once guardians of the Republic, into secret police.
See way down there? There's a woman taking photos of the dam. Someone called 911 and reported a suspicious person. As you guessed, she's gonna be a Category 3 hit. And since it's very important that we don't let her know that we know, both the dispatcher and the officer need to make sure she doesn't hear the radio traffic.
Stand by. If I could ask you to wait right here, please.
Sure.
Everyday items and activities are listed as proof that you are sympathizing with shadowy boogeymen of terror.
Of course, he's going to keep his eyes open for anything interesting or unusual in the car. That would include cameras, binoculars, video equipment, GPS, maybe things like sleeping bags that suggest they're living out of the car.
From their inception, Homeland Security and Northcom were set up to dominate the people and the states, not to fight the CIA-created Al-Qaeda.
What is the law? What laws apply to every single man on this earth? Because they often say no man is above the law. Okay, so which law are they talking about then? Well, there's common law, there's civil law, there's contract law, there's Sharia law, there's Christian law, like there's all kinds of laws. Mm-hmm. Admiralty is just one of them. And when it comes down to it, a lot of those are only associated to activities depending on what we're doing and what we consent to. So corporations, for example, are all subject to a number of laws because they are the creation of the government. So the master gives the rules for the servant to follow. Okay. So does that apply to you? Well, unless you're a corporation or you're behaving as a corporation, the answer is no. So I ask the question, what is the law?
Well, what's Canada defined as? In the Interpretation Act, Canada, for greater certainty, includes the internal waters of Canada and territorial sea of Canada. Okay, now that word includes is a tricky word. There's a legal maxim that says the inclusion of one is the exclusion of all others. Okay, so whenever you see the word includes, it means it's this and nothing else. Hold on here. You're trying to tell me that Canada is just water? Yes, it is. This red, that's Canada. We, sitting in this basement, we are not in Canada.
Canada, that's something.
Yeah.
This ain't Canada right now.
Oh!
This is in Canada right now?
No.
Wow.
No.
We're in
G20
right now.
That's right.
You're in G20.
G20 land is over there.
Well, the term Turtle Island, my understanding, is an actual word that the First Nations people called North America. When the Europeans came over, they then started putting their own terms and words to the land. However, it was all done through corporations.
Well, that's why they need the Admiralty Courts, because Canada is only water. You can't have law of the land if you have no land. You need Admiralty Courts to operate in Canada because it's all water. You need your ships. Okay. Everybody know where they fly the flag? On the Parliament buildings in Ottawa? On the top of the Peace Tower. Because they don't have any land to plant their flag. We need land to plant a flag.
Petro.
Yes, sir.
Stand by for operation of the time machine.
Yes, sir. Where to this time, Captain?
Back to the year 1215 in King John of England.
Yes, sir.
Everybody's familiar with Robin Hood, King John, you know, the tyrant, was actually real. The problem with King John is that he did not know how to fight a war, and he had no land to his name, so he ran to the Pope in 1213 and asked Pope Innocent III for some help. And what he did is he actually turned over the whole Kingdom of England to the Pope in return for support from the Pope so that he could fight his wars. So that little document essentially turned King John into the Pope's vassal, which means that he promised to be loyal to the Pope, and the Pope then owned everything in England. A couple years later, his barons, quartered him and, stuck a knife to him and said, you know what, we're not happy with the way you're treating us, we want you to sign this Magna Carta.
But if I sign this, I shall be no king. You have given me 24 overlords.
These 24 will see that you carry out the terms of the Magna Carta. You have no choice, King John, but to sign.
So the Magna Carta was the basis of English law.
That's right, Jet. And the basis of American law as well. The English Magna Carta became the model for the American Bill of Rights.
This is the founding document for our human rights within our country, within Great Britain, within the United States, Australia, New Zealand, South Africa, any crown colony, their legal systems are based on this document. But he was doing it at knife point. He's under duress. Is that a legal contract?
No.
So I have a question. If it was under duress and this is not a legal contract, then how can they possibly continue using this document as the basis for our legal system?
I would suspect that most people would recognize that a valid contract would require that the individual sign on his own free will. And that wasn't the case. And the Pope at the time, Pope Innocent III, recognized that as such because he also said that it was invalid.
People started coming over and started immigrating to what they thought was Canada or the United States. And then in 1867, they passed this thing called the British North America Act. Now, did the people here vote on this? No. This is a piece of legislation from Great Britain. That's all this is. The BNA Act is just legislation from the Parliament in Great Britain. But it was passed off on us as a constitutional document. In order for you to have a constitution, the people have to vote on the document, not the representatives in the legislature. This document merged all the colonies into one colony called Canada. That's all this document did. But it was passed off as forming a country.
The people of Great Britain went and started traveling around the world and bringing their legal system with them. And even though the U.S. declared their independence in 1776, they still based their legal system on British system. They're all based on that common law system, but there's also the Admiralty system that came with it.
Maritime Admiralty law is what's known as the law of the water. It is superseded by civil law and only applies to those who willingly contract themselves into it. The definition of Admiralty law is a body of private international law governing the relationships between private entities which operate vessels on the oceans. Let's look at how and why a form of law that is fashioned to govern corporations, businesses, and vessels has imposed its rule over natural human beings. This is all done through a form of word magic. A simple perversion of language has made it possible to convince people around the world that these alternative laws apply to them. One of the predominant beliefs in modern culture is that licenses, permits, registrations, and other forms of documentation are required to operate motor vehicles, use public roads, build structures and establishments, engage in free enterprise, and much more. Sadly, these beliefs are based on little to no investigation whatsoever and are false. This belief structure is perpetuated by maritime admiralty law. This form of law was originally created to govern ships docking in foreign nations for the import or export of products and resources. It deals with banking and merchant affairs, not civil affairs. When a product is taken off of a ship and brought into a foreign land, That nation takes custody of the resource and accounts for it with a certificate. That certificate marks the birth date of that product in the custody of the respective nation. Think of why it is supposedly required to have a certificate of live birth in the first place. The Barron's Dictionary of Banking Terms defines a certificate as a paper establishing an ownership claim. So right there, we notice that everyone with a birth certificate is defined as being owned.
Representatives from, you know, Canada, Australia, South Africa, New Zealand, you know, all those got together with Great Britain and started talking about, how can we really set things up so that we can be autonomous from Great Britain? And so they actually met for a couple years, 1926 and 1930, to formulate how this was going to work. And then the king then passed the Statute of Westminster, and that essentially broke the tie between Great Britain and Canada. Okay, the king is no longer a part of Canada. Canada is no longer affected by any statutes or regulations from Great Britain. Because the link to the crown was broken, technically we are in anarchy. We have no document to actually set up the framework for how our government is supposed to operate in this land. In 47, they wrote a letters patent creating the office of Governor General. The Governor General is the head of this country. So, Clause 1 says, we do hereby constitute. Who's we? I don't remember seeing any documentation that said the people of this land gave them permission to constitute that office. And the king doesn't have any authority here because the Statute of Westminster 1931 cut off all of that. So I have a question. Who's we? I suspect that it was Prime Minister Mackenzie King and all of his cronies. So how did all this happen? This guy here, our Prime Minister Mackenzie King, I did some reading on him. And I found out he's actually really good friends with John D. Rockefeller Jr. And he actually spent a lot of time in New York. He actually consulted with him. Mackenzie King's a lawyer, and he was actually Rockefeller's lawyer, and actually helped him out with a lot of labor disputes that are happening in the States. So who signed it? Prime Minister of Canada. So our Prime Minister signed a letters patent to create the office of Governor General. They needed to set up another office, so the Prime Minister did it. And I'm really curious to find out who was supporting him to do that. Because it wasn't the people, and it wasn't the king. Even though he said by His Majesty's command, I question that too. Governor General's Act. You go to a Canadian government website and you can actually look up the acts. Okay, you look up the Governor General's Act. And in there, Clause 2 says, the Governor General of Canada or other Chief Executive Officer, CEO, CEOs are for companies, or administrator carrying on the government of Canada on behalf and in the name of the sovereign, by whatever title designated, is a corporation's sole. Okay, a corporation's sole is a corporation, except that there's only one individual that holds that title or owns that corporation. Corporation souls actually are used all over the place. The Pope, the office of the Pope is a corporation soul. The office of the King is a corporation soul. The Governor General, Lieutenant Governors, the Catholic Church, all of their bishops and archbishops and cardinals, they all hold corporation souls.
What is a corporation? It is one form of business ownership.
It's a group of individuals working together to serve a variety of objectives, the principal one of which is earning large growing, sustained, legal returns for the people who own the business.
Corporations are artificial creations. You might say they're monsters trying to devour as much profit as possible at anyone's expense. The 14th Amendment was passed at the end of the Civil War to give equal rights to black people. And therefore, it said no state can deprive any person of life, liberty, or property without due process of law. And that was intended to prevent the states from taking away life, liberty, or property from black people, as they had done for so much of our history. And what happens is the corporations come into court, and corporation lawyers are very clever, and they say, oh, you can't deprive a person of life, liberty, or property. We are a person. A corporation is a person. And the Supreme Court goes along with that.
Everybody makes a mistake once in a while, but I just can't be personally responsible. That's one of the weaknesses of a partnership, isn't it, Sid?
Well, maybe you better incorporate the store.
Incorporate?
Yes. Incorporating would give you the big advantage of what you want right now. Limited liability. You start with a group of people who want to invest their money in a company. Then these people apply for a charter as a corporation. This government issues a charter to that corporation. Now that corporation operates legally as an individual person. It is not a group of people. It is under the law a legal person.
Imperial Steel Incorporated is many of the legal rights of a person. It can buy and sell property. It can borrow money. It can sue in court and be sued. It carries on a business. Imperial Steel, along with thousands of other legal persons, is a part of our daily living. It is a member of our society.
Having acquired the legal rights and protections of a person, the question arises, what kind of person is the corporation?
Corporations were given the rights of immortal persons, but then special kinds of persons, persons who have no moral conscience.
If you were going to do business with a corporation or a company in the world, then you can use Dun & Bradstreet, which at the moment is about 160 million corporations worldwide. You can use these to find out if that corporation does good business. Does it have any debts? Has it got any county court judgments against it? So what this is a register of corporations, of companies, and the members of Parliament are a company. Gordon Brown is a company. David Cameron is a company. And this one I like. The Labour Party trade as Alistair Darling MP. It's their trading name. It's just there. The reason they trade with Alistair Darling MP is because Alistair Darling is a diplomat. There's about three of them. If they trade in his name, that trading name has diplomatic status. That means they can bend things and do things that you don't know about. It's a whole different way of doing things. This is what politics is about. This is what you believe to be the people representing you are doing, but they're not. This is what they're doing. The United Kingdom is a corporation. Now, up till February of last year, it was United Kingdom PLC. In February, and it's dissolved, and they've never, ever published their accounts. If you want to check that out, go on Companies House, because it's there. On Dun & Bradstreet, they're now registered as United Kingdom Corporation Limited.
Take a look at the US Securities and Exchange Commission. You type in the word Canada, it's listed there. Canada actually has to file with the U.S. Security and Exchange Commission every year.
Canada is registered as a corporation. This corporation lists income tax payments as a stream of revenue for them, and they advertise this, they publish this information. If you imagine for a moment a temporary work agency, where you go in the morning and you sit there and they go, okay, we got a job for you, go to Jim's Construction and he's going to hire you. You go work for Jim's Construction, you have to give these people a little bit of money, don't you? Why? Because you're working as their agent. Same is true in the federal government. When you go and you give them your number, your social insurance number, and you work under that, you are being hired as an agent for the federal government or as an agent of the federal government, and it's the federal government providing that employer with these services. You've got every right in the world to say, I don't want to give you that number, I just want to engage in a contract with you. They don't want you doing this because it's all about control. And if I can trick you into being an employee instead of an owner, I get to rule you with the employee's rules.
Any corporation has employees. The employees are not just civil servants, they're all of you. Every one of you. If you have a national insurance number, that means you too are an employee.
Your social insurance number means you are a government agent. You are employed by the federal government as a government agent. The courts rule that payment into a pension plan is evidence of employee status. Only employees pay into a pension plan. If you want to pay into the Canada pension plan, you need a social insurance number. They used to call it unemployment insurance, now they call it employment insurance, because they ensure you are always employed. If you go to the federal government and you ask them, what is this number, you know what they identify it as? An employee identification number. Where do you get your employee identification number? You go to Canada, Human Resources Canada. Believe it or not, what they have done is they have tricked everyone into becoming an employee of the federal government, and now the rules that are made just for employees of this corporation or of the federal government are applicable to you because of that reason. If you are not an employee of the corporation, how can these rules apply to you? That's one of their big tricks, is they got you all to become employees of the government.
Company policy of this corporation requires you as an employee to pay tax, follow all the legislative rules of that corporation, in this case, statutes. As in any company, if you break the rules, you will be disciplined under that company's legislation. So when we look at the word statute, and I like this one, a legislative rule of society given the force of law by the consent of the governed. And I ask you, please, if you could explain to me where in that definition taken from Black's Law Dictionary that says that statute is law. The force of law, but it's not law.
What's the difference?
Right. I will get to that. Not quite yet, but I will get to it. From the neuter of, everybody must know this word status. Is what our society, what does it rely on? Status. Yeah? That's what we want to do, don't we? We want to be better in status. More money, bigger car, bigger this, bigger that, better than next door neighbour. That's the word, status. And it all comes from this. Status is the legal character of a condition or condition of a person or a thing. It's not real. It's imaginary. Okay? Completely imaginary. And in the definition, it actually shows that it's not law. It's given the force of law, which means it will apply to you if you consent. What does the word consent mean? Exactly. So what happens when you don't agree? It isn't law. Can't be given the force of law. By its own definition, it only applies to a person and not a man or a woman. How many people in the audience today think they're a person?
If I was to ask you, how do you define person, what would the normal definition of in our community be for that word?
Human being.
And if we take a look at the dictionary, it says a human being regarded as an individual. That's what we would normally view the word person to be. In law, okay, now we're using their words. Whenever you're dealing with corporations and the government and all that kind of stuff, person means an individual or incorporated group having certain legal rights and responsibilities. Not a human being regarded as an individual, but as an individual or corporation. So they actually said, compare artificial person and natural person. So I did. So I looked it up and I compared them. Artificial person. A legal entity, not a human being. Natural person. A natural person is a human being that has the capacity for rights and duties. Just because you have the capacity doesn't mean that you're going to use your free will to exercise them. You have the capacity for rights and duties, but it's up to you to exercise them.
Let's define the word person. Includes natural person, firm co-partnership, association, limited liability, company or corporation, legal personality. Well, I've got a problem with this. First off, was the first one we had was how can you define person with exactly the same word, because you're failing to define anything. And this is in Black's Law Dictionary, 8. If you look at person in Black's Law Dictionary 3, you'll see it's a fiction. Actually says it, it's a fiction. But it's not real.
The definition of person is a corporate fiction. Black's Law also tells us that the only person known to Canadian law is the corporation.
When your name is presented on a document with the first letter of your first and last name capitalized, it represents capitis diminutia minima, which occurs when a man's family relations alone were changed. It's a minimal loss of rights. When your last name appears in capital letters, it represents capitis diminutia media, which occurs when a man loses his rights of citizenship, but not his rights to liberty. This means you can be fined and penalized, but not enslaved or imprisoned. But when your entire name is capitalized on any document, it represents capitis diminutia maxima, which states that a man's condition changes from freedom to bondage. All rights of citizenship and family rights are surrendered. This means you can be fined, imprisoned, and enslaved in any amount for any duration at the whim of the state's suggestion.
You are a man or a woman, you have a person. My name is John Harris, or John, or my wife calls me lots of other names, but there you go. I shan't discuss them. I exist naturally, okay? I'm here, I'm real. I was created by divine, whatever you want to call it. I don't want to get into any of this sort of, I don't know what it is, so I just say divine, it's the easiest way. But I was created. I'm subject to common law jurisdiction. I must never harm another or cause another loss, any form of loss. I'm free and unlimited ability to contract and settle debt in private and under commercial law. I can basically do as I please as long as I abide by these principles. My person, which is attached to me, is Mr. J. Harris, who's a fictional entity created by the government. Subject to civil policy jurisdiction, must fulfil all duties given to and governed by corporate policy, tax, etc., under statute. Does business in the public sector, or I don't. So what is a person? Your person was created when your birth was registered and evidenced by your birth certificate. Man created government, which in turn created persons. Your person is not you. It is a legal fiction which you are falsely identifying with because you've been deceived. Massively. You don't get to say what its rights and duties are. The United Kingdom Corporation does. Like I said, you've been misled and you've been deceived. The creation of the person. When you were born, your mother, father, submitted a birth certificate registration application form. In the formulation of any limited company corporation, there is always a certificate of registration to create its legal personality. Your fictional person, known by Mr., Mrs., or blah, 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 you can see it up there, is created by the same means. When you submit, you are bending to another's will, okay? So you're bending, you're agreeing to bend to their will. When you register, you are handing over title ownership of whatever you're registering to whoever you are registering it to. You actually physically hand this over. And in doing this, you acknowledge the transferring of that authority. When you apply, it actually means you're begging. And when you beg, it's assumed you know what you're begging for, and you know what you're going to give up. That's what this means. Most of the time, you actually volunteer an application. You actually volunteer. You're not made to do it. Did I make you get a credit card? But you submit an application. Everything in this, the whole world is created, it runs on submitting applications for this, submitting applications for that. You get a certified copy, you do not get the original, because that goes somewhere else. This up here, when you actually look at this, you look at this, and you get your own. When you get home, or you get your kids, whatever, get this document and look at it, because it's phenomenal what they've done. The name of the person's being created in capitalized surname. See, the surnames are capitals, okay? It's a fiction. This is being created. That fiction is going to be created there. But what they need is, they need another fiction to do it. They have to have a fiction there to do this. Who is the informant? You actually inform on your own children. Do you know that? You inform on them. It's brilliant, isn't it? Eh? And your qualification is, you're one of their parents. Mad. And it's capitalised, it's all capitalised. And it is absolutely true. Look at your birth certificate, informant, the qualification needed, and it will say needed, and you inform because you are the father or the mother. What you don't know is that at the bottom, there is a declaration. Now, a declaration is in common law. A declaration is a sworn oath of a man or a woman. And there's a reason that's on the bottom. Because without that man or woman being present, the fictionless mother or father isn't present. Now you're seeing that the person is attached to the human being. But to do this, they need the human being to be there. That's why there's a declaration at the bottom of it. And this, it says it quite simply. You have to be present to represent the person needed to create the new person's legal personality. I know it's a tongue, believe me, it's mind-boggling, but it really is. This is what we've found, and it all makes sense. That's the point. This is what I want to tell you about it. And then you register it to a corporation. The General Register Office. Get your birth certificate and lift it up, and you'll see GRO. It's a General Register Office. That's who you're registering it to. Registration and your children. And this is not funny. This is really, really true. Okay? To this day, registration still means the same thing. You hand over or you transfer the legal title to the body you have registered it with. As you have seen, the worst possible way this has been done is by the birth certificate. It's been abused. A simple show of this is to... Do you have to mandatory school your children? Well, you do. And can you take them on holiday when you want to? No. Because what happens when you take them out of term time? I know people have received £100 fines for taking their kids out of term time, taking them on holiday. And they have to be vaccinated. The thing is, it's their property. You signed over title ownership of that child to the government when you registered it. You've got no claim to your children whatsoever. You just don't know it because you've been duped. If you want proof of it, the social services. What happens when you don't look after their property or they pertain you're not looking after their property properly? Linda Lewis, Baby P. What happens? They take the child away. What you'll notice is it says Social Services PLC, because it is a PLC. And a PLC is a public limited company that has shareholders, and shareholders need profits. And where do they get profit from? Stealing children.
The authorities are taking children away from their families for the most extraordinary reasons. I'll give you an example, and like I say, this is not rare. We had a case in Britain recently where these parents spent £38,000 on fertility treatment to have a child. When the child was born, soon after the child came home from the hospital, a social worker came round and the mother just joked that giving birth had ruined her figure. On the basis of that, the child was taken away. And we're seeing extraordinary examples of the so-called justification for taking children and the state taking control of them. And what then happens, and happens in this case, is the social services say to them, okay, we're taking your child away, we're going to give it to foster parents of our choice. Now you have a choice. You can either accept this, in which case you might see your children on, you know, access time here and there, or you can challenge this decision, in which case you'll never see your children again. And the decisions are then made in secret family courts, which are not allowed to be reported by the media, where a single judge is making the decisions. And, you know, if you describe this society to people a few years ago, you'd say, you've got to be talking about China, mate, ain't you?
On the screen, there's a little baby. That's Elizabeth Annie Lane. She's a little baby, came into my life. About 4.5 years ago, 2 days after the birth of Elizabeth, ministry workers came in, removed her, no investigation, no assessment, claimed she only had one caregiver. We said, you're wrong, we're a family, we're going to meet you in court. They told us if we tried doing that, they'd see to it. She spent the first 5 years of her life going from foster home to foster home to foster home. Shut me up in court, cost me my baby. Folks, anyone who knows me, shutting me up even for a moment is a bit of a trick. They cost me my baby. I sat down with their act, Black's Law Dictionary on one side, Bouvier's on the other. I had an old English dictionary. I looked up every single word in there. It took me 3 days. Nothing but toast and tea and a couple of tokes. Took me 3 days and I finally saw it. Have you ever seen these laser pictures? You see nothing until you focus past it. And then a 3D picture pops into your head. Have you seen those? This is exactly what I saw when I did my statute deconstruction. I looked through and I suddenly saw what they were doing. This is their little trick. You are not obliged to register your children. If you do, it is at that point that you're creating a legal entity or a person. You are associating this person with your offspring. You are abandoning ownership or title to that person. And the government is seizing that under the laws of maritime salvage. It becomes their chattel property. They use it as collateral to float loans or to float bonds for loans.
Woodrow Wilson, as you may know, for any of you who have done any research into the Federal Reserve, the central bankers, and the fiat currency system that we've been enslaved into, you'll know that Woodrow Wilson is the president who signed into law the Federal Reserve Act. And you may already know that the Federal Reserve is a private corporation. It's not federal, it has no reserves, it's a private corporation owned by offshore bankers. There was a man named Edward Mandel House, and he was Woodrow Wilson's handler. House was an Englishman, actually the Earl of Grey was his handler. Anyways, they had to put the Federal Reserve Act through in 1913 before the United States could enter into the First World War. The bankers wanted to fund America, incur debt and interest, and so they had to foment a condition whereby the United States would enter the First World War. But first they had to have the Federal Reserve Act through, so they ran that through in 1913. Now the reason, the official reason why the United States entered the First World War was the sinking of the Lusitania. You just need to watch The Money Masters by William Still and you'll find out the history of all this. The sinking of the Lusitania was orchestrated by Mandel House. He's not a nice guy. And here's what he had to say in a private meeting with Woodrow Wilson. Very soon, every American will be required to register their biological property. That's the birth certificate. They'll be required to register their biological property in a national system designed to keep track of the people and that will operate under the ancient system of pledging. By such methodology, we can compel people to submit to our agenda, which will affect our security as a chargeback for our fiat paper currency. Every American will be forced to register or suffer not being able to work and earn a living, the sin. They will be our chattel. That means slaves, means collateral. You're secured as collateral. They will be our chattel, and we will hold the security interest over them forever. By operation of the law merchant under the scheme of secured transactions, Americans, by unknowingly or unwittingly delivering the bills of lading to us, will be rendered bankrupt and insolvent, forever to remain economic slaves through taxation secured by their pledges, the birth certificate. They will be stripped of their rights and given a commercial value designed to make us profit, and they will be none the wiser, for not one man in a million could ever figure out our plans. And if by accident one or two would figure it out, we have in our arsenal plausible deniability. After all, this is the only logical way to fund government, by floating liens and debt to the registrants in the form of benefits and privileges. This will inevitably reap us huge profits beyond our wildest expectations and leave every American a contributor to this fraud, which we will call social insurance. Without realizing it, every American will insure us for any loss we may incur in this matter. Every American will unknowingly be our servant, however begrudgingly. The people will become helpless and without any hope for their redemption. We will employ the high office of the president of our dummy corporation to foment this plot against America. Canada is a corporation. The United States is a corporation. The President of the United States is the president of a dummy corporation.
The president is the chief executive officer of this corporation called the United States of America.
There's a corporation that runs the United States. The U.S. corporation was incorporated around 1871, and they changed the constitutional verbiage from the Constitution of the United States to the Constitution for the United States, and that was for the new corporation that we now live under, which is why it's so easy for them to change the laws, and so readily. They don't care about the violating the Constitution, because the Constitution is for a corporation now, not for the natural Constitution that was supposed to be given to us by our founding fathers.
I'm sure many of you have read court rulings from the Supreme Court of Canada. In a free and just society, this might be acceptable, Ask yourself this: what's the name of your society? Do you have one? There's a maximum law that says if you know not the name of a thing, all knowledge of that thing must perish. If someone tells you, I'm going to my best friend's house, and you say, really? What's your best friend's name? And they go, do they even have a best friend? Believe it or not, any member of a society, every member of a particular society, will all do the exact same thing if you ask them the right question. If you ask them, what is the name of your society, every member of that society will say the exact same thing. Societies have names. In British Columbia, it's the Society of Notary Publics of British Columbia, the Law Society of British Columbia. If you are a member of a society, you will have a card. Your picture will be on it. It will have evidence that you've been paying your dues, and you will be able to tell me the name of your society. Now, if you can't even tell me the name of your society and you know a statute is a legislated rule of a society which has been given the force of law, and you don't have a society, why do these acts have any force of law over you? Believe it or not, all of these statutes, they are a legislated rule of a particular society which had been given the force of law, but that's the law society. All of these rules are the rules for the law society, and you can prove it. Only they can make the statutes, the regulations, or the orders. You are not allowed to pen these. If you go into court, only they claim that only they may use these documents or these words, only they can claim complete understanding of these words. Unless you're a member of that society, you cannot understand these words. Why? Because societies have a number of powers. As a society, you can generate and create your own rules, and no one who is not a member of that society is going to have a say in creating those rules. You can claim that no one but a member of that society can understand those rules because you can actually create your own language as a society if you want. And you can do this by taking an existing language, oh, let's call it English, and you can change just a few words, not tell anyone else how those words have been changed, and guess what? You've got an entirely new language that appears to be English, but it's not, and only they know it.
So what is legalese? It's a language that can be, a language can be created by any society. Corporation can be such a society. Legalese is such a language. In English, it is English, but some words have very, very different meanings. Example, legalese is the language of the law society. Check it out for yourselves. One of the things I was going to say before I come on and I forgot is to say to you, do not take a word I'm saying as being the truth. Don't. Go and look at this stuff yourself, because that's the only way that you will suddenly realise what's going on. The truth is only the truth when you know, when you realise it. I could tell you all afternoon long, but until you realise it, it's meaningless. It's down to you to realise this. The examples. Must is synonymous with the word may. When someone says to you from a corporation, you must, they're actually giving you a choice because they can't force you. They're not allowed to, because it's not law. It's only policy. Summons is synonymous with invitation. When you get a summons from a court of supposedly law, you actually are being invited to a corporate place of business to discuss how much money you're going to give that corporate place of business. And you won't get an eight for it either. Understand is synonymous with stand under. If I say to you, do you understand? And you say yes, that means you stand under me, which means you've given me authority over you. It's as simple as that. It's so simple. But this is a language you don't know. You don't know you've been spoken to by this language. A policeman, a human being, his duty under common law of this land is to serve and protect every individual in this land. You've heard Albert say this today. That is his duty. That is what he does his job for, to serve and protect and never, ever delay right or justice to any individual in this land. That's their job. They must uphold the common law, but they have a fiction attached to them called a police officer. Now, if you look at the word officer, it comes from the corporate world. What's a CEO? Chief Executive Officer. It's all officers. They're unbelievable. This man on my right is who enforces statutes on you. This man protects you. But the trouble is, the boys in blue, who I have all the admiration in the world for, because I've got a lot of friends in the police force, don't know the difference. They don't know the difference anymore. And some of them didn't know the difference in the first place, because they're being told wrong. They're not being told about this bit, they're only being told about this bit. And funny enough, I had a conversation with Albert the other day, and he was telling me some things that are going on in the police force regarding their training at the moment. And all of them are being trained to be this. I want you to watch this little video, and the man who made this video is actually up there.
the camera down for
Can I help you?
Put the camera down for
I'm in my own garden here, mate.
Okay.
What, well, you come bursting down?
Filming the police.
It's not an offence at all.
It is, sir.
No, it's not an offence at all. I'm a filmmaker, mate. I know the laws. I've been doing this for years, mate. I film the police all the time. It's not an offence.
Okay. We're telling
you. What section is it an offence under?
Okay. It's an offence, sir.
What section is it an offence under?
I'll find out for you. Can you switch the camera off?
No, I can't switch my camera off. I'm not doing nothing wrong. I'm in my own garden. You've come round our path. I do this all the time, mate.
Yeah, if you can.
Get
this, you know.
Get the mobile phone, this solicitor. Mate, this is a free country. You're entitled by law, yeah?
Sorry, it's Claire.
You
got
an
ITIN number
from
the
Sarge? Sarge, just quickly, we've just done a stop check on the Welsh Eye Farm. There's a gentleman here that's filming us.
Yeah, he's in his own garden, minding his own business. And the police have just come over here intruding on my privacy, my liberty, my freedom. It's not illegal. I do this all the time. I film the police all the time down here. I film the inspector at the meetings, mate. Just I think you've got it wrong.
What's your name? Sorry, sir.
I think you've got it wrong, right?
What's your name?
Do you know what you ought to do, mate? If you don't like me filming you, you do what I do. You go to see the MPs, yeah, and get them to bring it up in Parliament so they can change the laws. But don't come and harassing me over
it. What's your name? Sorry, sir.
It doesn't matter who I am, mate, you know.
You're number 58.
You know. I'm not doing anything wrong at all, mate. Nothing wrong at all. You just took it on your own head to come over and harass me. You know? This is England, mate, you know?
Yeah, it's
158,
sir.
This isn't communist China, you know that, mate, don't you? I think it's terrible what you're doing here. Yeah, it's not an offence, mate, see? We can more pick that up better than your ears.
Pardon?
I said, we can more pick it up better than his ears.
Pick what up?
It doesn't matter.
What do you mean, pick what up?
It doesn't matter. You're just trying to make an issue here and I'm not biting for you. I'm not doing anything wrong.
What did you say?
I'm not doing anything wrong.
What have you just said to that?
It doesn't matter. I'm not doing anything wrong. I haven't done anything wrong. What are you trying to make an issue for? I've not broken no laws.
Yeah.
You come over here harassing us, mate. Thank you. Have a nice day.
What you saw there in that video was two police officers trying to get a man to give his name and his address. Because in the world of a police officer, they can only act on you if you contract with them, because it's the world of contracts. Remember, the statutory instrument is a legally written, contract. So they're contracts. He needs you to give your name and your address because he needs to act on your person, not the man or the woman. Darren, who would admit it as well, we stood up there, didn't actually know what he was doing at that time, and he's laughing his head off because he didn't. But the point is, this is natural. It's inherent. It's already in you. You've just been conditioned to not know it. That's all that's happened. When Darren wouldn't conform, what did the lady officer try and do? She tried to pick a spoil with him over any issue she possibly could find to try and enforce a statute. Now that is not a policeman or woman. That is not upholding the law of this land, the real law of this land. Okay, that is a corporate enforcement policy agent. So you now understand there is a big difference between the two, a massive difference.
What can I do for you? What can I do for you?
I just need, have you got an ID or anything?
Got any ID on
you? I don't. But do you understand why you shouldn't stop and just randomly ask for people's ID? This is America, bro.
Stop walking.
What's your name?
I don't feel I have to give it to you if I haven't done anything wrong.
Well, I'm asking you for your name.
All I'm wanting is an ID.
I can't do that unless you have a lawful reason to ask me.
Okay, if an officer of the law asks you for your name, you're supposed to provide that to them.
Okay? Not if I haven't done anything wrong, sir.
Every day we get stopped. Every day we get ID'd. You can't go anywhere in America anymore without your papers.
Why? Death breach, Kit Carson County. You guys got ID on you?
The corporate employees must get a man or a woman to represent the person before a contract can be formed. That's absolutely true. They will ask you your name, they'll ask you your address. When they get your address, they've got joinder. Because I could be, they could be 100,000 John Harris's in England. They need that address to get joinder, so they can prove who you are. The second you do that, the human being has said, yes, I'm the person. Whenever you're stopped by one of these individuals, ask them this: am I obliged to ask your questions? Because they won't know what the word obliged means. They won't know what it means. And it's a choice. It's a choice. And then ask them, under what authority and under what law are you acting? The reason being is because if they say to you, it's under this law, and then they suddenly say, and you prove it's a statute, an act of parliament, that says it in itself, an act. Parliament, that's all it is. It's theatre, it's an act. Shakespeare said it, the world's a stage, and we're all acting. It's absolutely true. But when you say to these people, you can actually say this, and this is absolute fact, because I'm just about to do this to the Chief Constable of Devon and Cornwall Police. Failure to differentiate between a statute and a law is gross negligence that's equivalent to the common law crime of fraud. They're committing fraud. They've committed fraud on you from the day you were born. This applies to anyone who is trying to enforce these statutes. This is what I entered into. And it's called lawful rebellion. It's actually wrote in Magna Carta 1215. It's Article 61. Now, I know a lot about Magna Carta now, and I know that Magna Carta certainly wasn't right for us. And we've got no, we can't use it. We can't use it. But we can use the method of lawful rebellion, because lawful rebellion says, and what Article 61 actually says, it says, lawfully hinder, and it says, you never, must never ever use violence. We can't sort this out with violence. Because if we sort this out with violence, violence will always ensue. We have to do this peacefully. And the way we do it peacefully is learning the rules of the game.
For my own protection, I'm filming it. I'm wondering what he's going to do. He's reading my affidavit of truth right now. So I'll get back to you. He's also stated that I'm under obligation to carry photo ID, which I'm obviously not. That's the officer right there, car 77. So hopefully,
Bye.
There we go, car 77. Officer did not state who he was. There's another police officer showing up. I've already informed the officers of my rights, this and that. Cold. Officer, I just want to let you know I'm activating my fee schedule. It's the middle of winter. I am cold right now. And you're harassing me right now. So my fee schedule will be activated in 3 minutes. I suggest you contact a superior officer. Read that affidavit of truth.
We're reading that right now, sir. We're taking, trying to get.
I know, I'm just freezing cold. Okay. I'm freezing cold, so.
Okay.
For the record, I also informed the officer I was operating under protest and duress.
Hey, all those documents come back.
Hey, perfect. Here you go, Joshua. So, you don't have a driver's license, correct?
No.
And no insurance, correct? Do you have insurance?
No. I'm working on that right now, doing it through
it's a registered
motor vehicle, right? So it's not under you guys' jurisdiction. I'm not trying to cause trouble or nothing, but I am getting insurance on it. But it's through my society that I'm part of.
Okay, perfect.
So I don't, obviously, like, I only use it to travel around and get my girlfriend.
You are dealing with a human being. They are just human beings. They'll tell you I'm an agent for the government, I'm a peace officer, I'm this, I'm that. No, you are a human being in a common law jurisdiction, and that's all there is to it. That's first and foremost, and I'm not forgetting that. If you remember that, they have to remember that. The key thing about remembering this is you can remember a couple of things. Yes, you can affect them. You can use, they will respond to emotion, they will respond to threats, they'll respond to a baseball bat in the bottom of their knee. They will respond. They will also respond to love, compassion, and truth. They are human beings, and if you treat them with the dignity that all human beings are worthy of, they will respond as a human being as well.
Are you recording me right now?
Yes.
Are you trying to make a point?
No, it's for my protection.
Oh, this is not a third world nation. I'm a retired Marine too. Of course you can.
Thanks for my rights, sir.
Yeah, well, let me ask you this. If you're a police officer, what do you want to do? Make sure it's safe, right?
Correct.
You're lawful, you did what you're supposed to do. Can I see some identification to verify who you are?
I have any on me.
You have none on you?
No.
Okay, let me just take your name down. You haven't got anything else on here, right?
I'm not required to provide my information.
Well, you're required to identify who you are. You don't have to show identification. You can do it verbal. Can you do that?
You can't
do that at all. Okay.
There's not a stop 90 stature.
What's your last name? Jeremy?
I'm not going to tell you your last name.
Okay. You're not going to load up, right, while you're walking down the street?
No.
Okay. Well, it should look good on YouTube either way. You already getting code 4?
Yes.
I don't know. Sometimes people do it. I understand. And you're right. I'm the first one to be an advocate for that. Make sure you get a good picture of me so you know exactly what I look like. Because you've got a statement to make here. I'm all for that, believe me. After 22 years in the Marine Corps, I don't have a problem with that. The problem I have is that we also have a lot of folks during the holidays, but sometimes they have other issues going on, and we don't know what your agenda is.
Okay.
Jeremy, thanks for your cooperation.
Thank you, sir.
And remember, my name is Officer Lyons with the Oceanside Police Department. My badge number is 1093. God bless America.
Right.
See you later, Jeremy.
Don't look at them as anything more than simply a human being using a tool. And the tool that they are using is words. If someone comes up to you and points to a body of words and says, this body of words gives me authority over you, and you say, really? What does that word right there mean? And they say, I don't know. What just happened to their authority? Gone. They have to know what the words in their own mandates mean. And this is where we have what their tool that they use against us, now we're going to use it against them, because some of these words are very deceptive. They're ambiguous at least. These deceptive words, words that have ambiguous meanings that open up and allow for a change in the, or a shift in the power structure, these words are deceptive, they're ambiguous, you can ask questions. You can bring these human beings who are using words to claim authority, ask them questions concerning the deceptive words, and if they don't know the answer, their authority is gone. You don't need any anger, you don't need any hatred, you don't need any violence whatsoever, just a mind and ask some questions.
A difficult thing for some people to understand is what's happening today is not just an elite making a final move to take over anything. Every generation for hundreds of years has been brought up with the same elite's predecessors designing and running the show for each generation. The elite, in fact, are simply moving their system into a new system, an updated system to suit themselves. That's a hard concept for people to grasp. They've been trained to believe things are happening at the moment by happenstance, by crisis coming out of nowhere, and here's what we must do. We must solve this problem at the time. Nothing is further from the truth.
We have before us the opportunity to forge for ourselves and for future generations a new world order, a world where the rule of law, not the law of the jungle, governs the conduct of nations. When we are successful, and we will be, we have a real chance at this new world order, an order in which a credible United Nations can use its peacekeeping role to fulfill the promise and vision of the UN's founders.
Why don't we learn from the mistakes of our ancestors? Why does humankind find itself bound in a cycle of bloodshed and enslavement?
If we look now at the speed at which this police state is being imposed and this political centralization is being imposed, then forget the speed it's been imposed in up to this point, fast as it's been since 9/11, because the more power they centralize and therefore have in their hands, the quicker they can introduce this police state. So we're going to see it getting faster and faster until humanity wakes up and starts to decide it wants to take a different course. Because if it doesn't, if we sit on our backsides and watch the latest soap and watch the news and believe what we're told, if we go on in that dream world, then we are going to live in a world envisaged and described by Orwell, basically, within 10 years.
If the New World Order succeeds, you're looking at an invincible police state. You're looking at a brainwashed population with brainwashed secret police who literally just press on the nerve of power, as George Orwell said, and we're looking at a boot stomping on a human face forever.
If you want a vision of the future, Winston, imagine a boot stamping on a human face forever.
What we are going to see more of as these years unfold is more chaos problems created to create more fear, because that's the four-letter word that controls the world. Once people are in fear, they look outside of themselves for someone or something to protect them from what they've been manipulated to fear. A population or a person who's not in fear is a nightmare to manipulate and control. Someone who's in fear, piece of cake.
This generation today, the ones who are alive today, we are the generation that's going through the biggest changes in history, according to even Rockefeller himself, since the Industrial Revolution. It's the end of one part, one phase of a long-term plan. And out of this comes a new world order. As they've said, Mr. Brown said, the Prime Minister of Great Britain, said at the G20 meeting recently, it's a new world order, a different order from the previous one, where people technically, were working for themselves, would choose their own employment and so on. The new world order is a planned system, a planned economy, a planned population. So it's up to us. It's not up to the next generation to change this. We're the only ones who can possibly do the changing.
How long is it going to be before you finally resist and say, no, I will not comply, period? That's a different answer for each person. Ask yourself now, because sooner or later you're going to come to that line, and when they cross it, what are you going to say? Well, okay, cross this line. Okay, now cross that line. Okay, now cross this line. And pretty soon, you're in a corner. Sooner or later, you've got to draw a line and stand your ground, whether anybody else does or not.
So, are we going to make a stand now and draw a line in the sand and say here and no further, in fact, we're going to roll this back? Or are we going to wait until it's got really, really extreme, by which time there'll be so much infrastructure in place that drawing a line in the sand will be a serious challenge? And it's no good. I said to some policemen in Parliament Square a few months ago, ask yourself, when your child says to you, Mummy and Daddy, what were you doing when the police state was introduced? Oh, well, I was watching the telly, honey. Or in the policeman's case, I was helping to introduce it, dear. That's the situation we're facing. And you know, if people don't like it, well, they just have to do the other thing, because this is how it is. And we either face it now, or we face it a little bit further along the road, when if we think it's not very good now, it'll be a bloody nightmare by then. It's time to lift the arse off the sofa and bring an end to this nonsense. Because otherwise, we're just building our own prison cell or sitting around where someone does it. Is that sensible? I think not.
We have been labeled rebels, traitors, enemies of the state. All terms King George would have used to vilify our founders. I, for one, will always rebel against oppression, a traitor only to tyranny, and I would be remiss to not make myself the enemy of a state that so blatantly tramples our freedoms. American values have been nearly vanquished by consumerism, militarism, and authoritarianism. Yellow ribbons and lapel pins will not save this country. When injustice becomes law, resistance becomes duty. The utmost manifestation of love and devotion to America is today, as it always has been, resistance of tyranny. Resist we must, and resist we will. We will not be silent. We will not obey. We will not let our government destroy our humanity. We will not wait another moment in fear to stand up for what we know to be right. It is time we start meeting oppression with resistance. They cannot stop us. Humanity marches on. You can fight it or fight for it. When we say revolution, we say it with love. This young movement is getting past the external wounds to the greater evils plaguing this nation. We know that the greatest threat to American security is the current corruption of our government. No politician has ever ended a war. Civil rights were won in this country not by any legislator, but by a movement. I have great hope for America, but it comes not from any election. No, my hope comes from you. Our tragic love affair with the state has led us to put far too much trust in a government that we thought could improve our lives, but has instead come to rule our lives for us. We have become, as a people, like a frightened, battered, beat-down victim of an abusive relationship. A servile, unquestioning, obedient people will always produce tyrants. We must, as a nation, once again, embrace defiance, rebellion, and resistance. More and more Americans are avoiding unenforceable taxes, leaving government jobs out of disgust, and sending their kids to college instead of combat. But our efforts as a movement must become unified and deliberate to fully withdraw our support and compliance. Be it with your lives, labor, or tax dollars, stop investing in your own oppression. Guard your communities from the police state. Don't waste a single vote or a single dollar on the two-party system. Do not be content merely to grumble and to march while they are using fear, force, and violence as weapons of oppression. We must embrace the opportunity to resist civilly while we still can. It has been said that when in the course of human events, an oppression so revolts its subjects that it becomes necessary to alter or abolish the means of that tyranny, is it that time when our Bill of Rights is defiled every day? When our adventures abroad threaten our security at home? When the Federal Reserve keeps our free nation enslaved by debt? When the people of the world tremble under the thumb of corporate imperialism? And now, our nation is drifting dangerously from freedom to fascism. So I have to ask, is it time?
TV, the Drudge Report,
Infowars.com. The whole world's watching. And what we learned from Texas will be used in other states to beat you globalist agents and mercenaries.
That's right.
And when we take America back, you Nazis are going to prison. Believe it. The lobbyists that serve tyranny, the politicians that serve tyranny, are going to prison. This is only the beginning. The answer to 1984 is 1776.
In the end, we will remember not the words of our enemies, but the silence of our friends. Silence is consent. Can you hear us now? Silence is consent. Because while we're silent on these impositions, the impositions just keep going on and on and on. By our silence, we are acquiescing, even agreeing to them being imposed. The end of silence, the end of acquiescence. If we want to be free, then don't run and hide. Comply! No! No, no! Not if it's enslaving me and my children and imposing on my freedom. Comply! Leave your home now it's foreclosed. No! 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 Let's follow this through, shall we? Millions of people in the world are losing their homes, being foreclosed, and ending up homeless. Let's follow this through. Why have you lost your home, my friend? Because I can't pay me mortgage. Why can't you pay your mortgage? Because I lost me job. Why did you lose your job? Because the great banking collapsed. They can't get this. I can't get my company went bust. And who's taking your home away and saying you've got to leave? The banks that caused the freaking problem. And we are leaving? What are we doing? What are we doing? No, we won't leave when the banks have caused the problem and now they're telling us to leave to take the assets. No, we won't. And people who are not being foreclosed need to support those that are. We're all in this together. You must do what we say. We have changed the law. Not if you are imposing on my freedom and my rights to be a free citizen with a free voice. No, no, no. What are they going to do? They come out of Downing Street, whether it's Clegg and his mate, bloody Cameron, or it's bloody Obama, whoever it is in America. And they say, we've had a discussion and this is what we're going to do. What if vast numbers of people say, well, we ain't doing it? They've got no power whatsoever. Their power comes in our acquiescence. Oh, but you can't defy the law. Okay, let's follow this through, shall we? By the way, while I'm talking, put your arms out and I'll put the handcuffs on, because that's what you're telling me. What you're telling me is this. We have no say in laws that are passed. And then we have to obey those laws. Well, okay, forget freedom then. Okay, what if they passed a law that says, we take your children away? Would you obey it? No. So there is a line then. There is a line. It's just, where is that line? And if a law does not respect human freedom, it does not respect human justice, it doesn't respect fair play, we should not be acquiescing to those laws. We should be refusing to acquiesce. What we need is not compliance, we need a non-comply dance. Where we beat to a different drum and we dance to a different drum. Where we refuse to acquiesce to this control system that seeks to enslave us even more than it already has. Non-comply dance. Do this, comply. No. No. But we need to do it en masse. Oh, we do it with a smile on our face. We're consciousness, all that has been ever will be. Why shouldn't we have a smile on our face? And smile and feel for these people who are enclosed in mind trying to enslave us. I am all that is, has been, ever will be. You cannot grant me my freedom. It is not your gift to grant me my freedom or take it away, because I am, we all are, freedom. Enough. Enough of this suppression. Enough of this slavery. Enough of this enslavement of the few by the many. Human race, get off your knees. What are we doing down there? As the poet Shelley said, rise like lions after slumber in unvanquishable number. Shake your chains to earth like dew, which in sleep had fallen on you. Ye are many, they are few. Enough! It's time to fly. It's time to fly. Thank you very much.
There's a time when the operation of the machine becomes so odious, makes you so sick at heart, that you can't take part, you can't even passively take part, and you've got to put your bodies upon the gears and upon the wheels, upon the levers, upon all the apparatus, and you've got to make it stop, and you've got to indicate to the people who run it, to the people who own it, that unless you're free, the machine will be prevented from working at all.
Somewhere a perversion has taken place. Our natural, unalienable rights are now considered to be a dispensation of government. And freedom has never been so fragile, so close to slipping from our grasp as it is at this moment. The martyrs of history were not fools. And our honored dead, who gave their lives to stop the advance of the Nazis, didn't die in vain. Where then is the road to peace? Well, it's a simple answer after all. You and I have the courage to say to our enemies, there is a price we will not pay, there is a point beyond which they must not advance.